So for this episode of Up Mid, back here with the local democracy reporter, Sarah Booker-Lewis, and with our committee update. And it's an exciting week this week, so we've got full council as well. But we're going to start off with disabled access for in the city, and about this public question about blue badges. Tell us all about it.
Well, actually, it wasn't about blue badges. It was about disabled access. And it was badge campaigner Pippa Hodge. Now, badge actually stands for... Brighton Access for Disabled Groups Everywhere. And it's quite rare for a question from the public to come up at planning. But what Miss Hodge wanted to know was the disabled access to Rockwater, the roof terrace there. Now, originally in its plans, there were plans for an external lift to take people to the roof terrace. And Equalities Act requires all new builds must be fully acceptable. Miss Hodge, she has a son who's a wheelchair user, and she's campaigned on many issues, blue badge access to Madeira Drive being one of them, which is probably why you made that point. And as well as the issues with the disabled bays on the seafront by the cycle lane and home to school transport, all sorts. So she wanted to know, why was this terrace allowed to open when it isn't fully accessible? And it turns out that actually a redesign went through in August, because the original lift location, when work started, it proved that actually it wasn't suitable. It wasn't stable enough for the lift. So they got a redesign, and that went through in August. And what Leo Lippman, the chair of planning, explained was the company now has until the 5th of February to install that lift on the outside of the building, or it must close its roof terrace because it won't be fully accessible and therefore legal. And so a spokesperson for the company has said that it will install it and it will happen by February. But what this raised really at planning was the issue of accessibility. And she's really pushing for better disabled access. And she asked the planning committee to have proper training related to the Equalities Act so that they think about disabled access when dealing with publicly accessible buildings. Yeah. One of her big frustrations is that the council still hasn't recruited a disabilities equalities officer, which makes things difficult in turn. Yeah. And that brought disabled access very much to the forefront of councillors' minds at that meeting.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's difficult here at the Natives Music Bar because it's a listed building. So some buildings are quite hard to make accessible for people with disabilities. But you're right. I mean, we need equal access. So it's an important point. And the training's probably a good idea as well, I would have thought, to make people more aware of the law, because it's not an optional extra. It's the law, isn't it?
Exactly. Yes. It is very difficult. I mean, thankfully, I've never had to personally be in a wheelchair, but I have helped someone around a place in a wheelchair. And it almost seems like they're invisible to other people. Yeah. I was having to push it. It was my sister really smashed her leg up, and I was pushing her around Chessington World of Adventures with her daughter. And people were just sort of walking into her. And I thought, for goodness sake, she's a person here in a chair. So if you live your, it really just made me appreciate, just for a couple of months, exactly what people in wheelchairs go through all the time.
Yeah, exactly. And we have Ricky Perrin from Sussex Wheelchair Basketball in a lot. So we're well aware of the disability issues as well, which are really important. Waiting for neighbours with the Brighton College Performing Arts Centre, and what neighbours are saying about that. Tell us a bit about that issue.
This is where Pippa Hodge's points came up again, The neighbours have had a lot of concerns about this development. They're going to have to wait another month for the decision, because it put disabled access in the committee's mind. And this new performing arts centre has a 400-seat theatre, and some of it is on the balcony where all the technical elements are based, like lighting and sound. But this balcony, it turns out, is not wheelchair accessible. And the Theatre's Trust made a comment in its comments about the application, saying that actually that needs more consideration, because it's not just the students at the school. They may have a theatre company come in who may have a lighting or a sound engineer who has accessibility issues. They won't be able to get to that technical area. And that was something that Councillor Ebel, Mariana Ebel, raised. And she wants to see that made wheelchair accessible. Now, what councillors were told was making it accessible by installing a lift would add bulk to the roof. Now, this is quite a large building. It's got a cantilevered roof that sort of sticks out a bit, and planning officers didn't want any extra bulk added to it. But I think the councillors are saying, come on, you know, we can't say that you can have one thing and not another. And Councillor Yates, he backed Councillor Ebel all the way and said, you know, if they want extra seats in a balcony, then they need to make sure that there is access. And he asked for the deferral until November. And he also had backing from Sue Shanks, the another Green councillor. Now, something that she was concerned about was there was a lack of detail about community access to this building. It was mentioned, oh, yes, the community will be able to have access. But she wanted a bit of hard detail on that. And she said, you know, would it be available to Brighton Youth Centre, which is just down the road, who would love to have access to something, a full-size theatre to produce a show in? I mean, the Youth Centre needs a new building as it is, and yeah, work is underway to try and sort that out with funding. But also some of the local schools, the children in Queen's Park Primary School, they're just down the road. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing? So they're actually after some more detail. And one of the things the neighbours were concerned about was parking and people going, parents just going to watch a production. There wasn't enough detail. So that is coming back next month.
Interesting. Yeah, some good points there about, I mean, and with private schools as well, you know, because they have charitable status. So the whole idea that, you know, to give back to the community. So I think there's some interesting points that were raised there, Sarah.
Yes, the charitable status was brought up because they do benefit. They have massive fees. They don't pay the same level of tax because they're a charity.
Yeah.
So yes, the community should benefit. And there are some deprived areas near Brighton College. So, you know, there are young people who could really benefit. And actually something Councillor Yates said was most of us have never walked past inside the gates of that amazing listed building in its own conservation area at the front. So yeah, the community should have something from that.
Yeah, exactly. Bin strike. We can see the bins overflowing, can't we, everywhere now. So just tell us a bit about the bin strike and an update on that. And obviously this could change at any point, but this is how the situation at the moment. Yeah,
it is a completely movable feast at the moment. Yeah, so at the Policy and Resources Committee, this is where all the leading councillors come together and really form policy. They did have a secret meeting. I was chucked out at the end. It was very, very kind of the council leader, Phelan McCafferty, who said, sorry, Sarah, you've got to go now. But it wasn't just me. He chucked out most of the officers as well. They are having these bin strike negotiations. We're 1 week in. We've got another week of this current strike, a 3-day break, and then another 2 weeks if something doesn't happen. So I think most people do realise, I'm still seeing people saying, is there a strike on? You know, where you see the communal bins are absolutely piled high with rubbish next to them. So what Councillor McCafferty said at this meeting, just at the beginning, was that councillors, even though they're not involved in the day-to-day management of City Clean, they have attended the talks and are very keen to listen to what the drivers have to say. Now, this strike is not about money. It's about industrial relations. It's about the drivers having their routes changed at short notice and just a breakdown in communication between these drivers and the management and council officers that run the team. Now, he said, you know, councillors are keen and ready to listen. But I was tweeting this out live, and the GMB branch secretary, Mark Turner, who is the man leading the bin driver strike, he said that actually the two councillors, the Amy Healy and Jamie Lloyd, who are the chair and deputy chair of Environment, Transport, Sustainability, were asked to leave the meeting. So even though people are saying, I want the councillors involved, they've asked them to leave. So that makes things a bit difficult. But he has said he actually wants to talk directly to Councillor McCafferty as the council leader. And that's not happening. So there's a lot of antagonism going on here. Everyone seems to be quite unhappy with the whole situation.
Yeah.
And we've just really got to see what's going to happen. This could go on and on and on. Now, what is being suggested to people at the moment, if they have nowhere to store their rubbish, which a lot of people, particularly in the city centre, can't do, you can't store it. You don't want to leave it next to those communal bins that are already just piled high with rubbish. You can walk it, if possible, to the tip at Hove. That has pedestrian access, but you have to take a vehicle to Brighton tip. Now, my husband went with our rubbish bag to Brighton at the weekend, and there was a queue, and the same at Hove. So my rubbish is in my garage at the moment, which is actually nowhere near my house. It's actually my husband's workshop with his toy car in it. So, yeah, we could be seeing a lot of weeping and grinding of teeth over rubbish for the next few weeks.
We're going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be back with Sarah Bukalos, local democracy reporter, talking about licensing panel issues. Join us then. So back here with Sarah Booker Lewis, local democracy reporter, and we're going to go on to licensing committee, licensing issues in this half. Tell us a bit about the licensing panels and about the teams that are currently being employed by the council.
The licensing panels have been held on the software teams.
Yeah.
For nearly 18 months now.
They have.
And so they're remote meetings because they're not held by the same legal requirements as the housing committee and other council committees. They can actually all be dealt with remotely. And the law changed in May, so all the committees had to go in person. But we've still been sitting of a morning, a couple of times a week, all on our remote software and discussing the licensing panel cases. Now, this is up for review this week at Licensing Committee, and the political group leaders are going to make a decision about how we're going to continue until February. Now, the positive thing about these remote meetings is that they've been webcast. So this is the first time that licensing panels have been webcast. They're usually everyone crammed in a tiny little office space or small meeting room in Hove Town Hall or Brighton Town Hall a couple of times, because they're not usually held in the council chamber. So there have been cases where the room has actually been too small to fit everyone in. When you've got three councillors, you've got a democratic services, you've got the lawyer, and then you've got maybe two people for the case. You've got me, you've got their lawyer. The police and licensing officers and so on. It can get really quite busy in there. And when if you're chucked in a little meeting room designed for eight people, it's just not going to happen. So, and of course, in these times, we do need to consider still our distance from each other and the ventilation. So another positive about holding remote licensing panels is it means that people don't have to travel. So all the councillors can be in their home offices. I'm at home. And you've got maybe a licensing consultant or a barrister who may have had to travel overnight and stay here. So the economy has missed out on their hotel room. But it means we're all there in the same place at 10 o'clock in the morning without traveling all over the place. The negatives are there have been technical issues. Every now and again, maybe someone drops off. It depends which internet service provider they're using. They may freeze and so on. So that does happen. But most of the time, we do manage quite well, and the decisions are made, and it's all simple. So we'll just have to wait and see. My gut feeling is we're probably going to continue remotely until February, and then see how things are then, because what they're being told is we do have to consider the public health issues.
Yeah, is that the only committee not meeting in person now then? Because I know the other committees
are, aren't they? Is that right?
Well, licensing panels are technically not a committee. They're not covered by the same section of the Local Government Act. So, yes, licensing panels are, and housing panels as well. They're meeting remotely. And next week, we have the Greater Brighton Economic Board. That's also meeting remotely. But then again, that's not a decision-making body. It's a discussion. So,
yes, exactly.
licensing enforcement list and about carriage drivers, well, taxi drivers, I guess, losing their license. Tell us a bit about that.
Yes. Now, this is coming up at licensing committee this week. We've had three Hackney carriage drivers have lost their licenses, and one private hired driver has also lost their license. Now, Hackney carriage drivers, they're the ones that you can hail like a taxi in the street, whereas private hire, you have to book in advance. Now, we've had a couple have lost their licenses because of links with drugs. They've been the council's been tipped off that they are transporting Class A drugs around the city and people involved with that. So, you know, that is a police matter, two drivers arrested. We've also had another lose their license for propositioning sex from a vulnerable young woman. Now, it's important to know that this action is being taken when people have slipped through the net, because any driver has to be a fit and proper person. They have to jump through a lot of hoops to get those licenses. Now, this is just a small number, and it is worth pointing out there are more than 1,000 Hackney carriage licensed drivers in the city and more than 200 private hire drivers. It is a very small number, and you are generally safe. But we're in times when people are thinking about women's safety in particular, more particularly in the wake of Sabina Nessa and Sarah Everard's murders in this year, you know. And as a woman, you do, wherever you go, you do feel generally safer getting into a taxi. So when you've had just one situation like this, it is very worrying.
It is.
And since 2019, all of Brighton and Hove's licensed drivers have undertaken safeguarding courses. And this has actually increased the intelligence that the council's received from drivers who about drivers involved in transporting passengers that are involved in drug supply. And some of the people they're transporting are under 16. So this is county lines and things like that, where young teenagers are recruited to distribute drugs. So it is something that is coming up for discussion at the licensing committee, because it's important that the councillors know they're in charge of the policy and they need to see that it's being enacted. But it is, as I say, a very, very small number of people, and I'm pretty sure that the rest of the drivers are happy to see them gone.
Yeah, exactly. And it
is generally pretty safe. You have to get a criminal records check, don't you, and all the rest of it. And you know, I always try and dial up a taxi, because then the person, that the call handler, knows that taxi's going there and where it's going to. So you've got another pair of eyes looking at the taxi. So there are ways you can improve your safety in a taxi as well. And also, I will try and make a phone call in a taxi, and then someone knows that they know that you'll know, someone else knows that you're arriving at a certain destination. So there's always a few tricks you can do. Lastly, then.
Well, yes, as a woman, I've known that for many years.
Yeah, exactly. licensing fees going to is this for taxi and private hire as well? Casinos, gaming, dog breeding, licensing fees.
Yes, it is actually quite amazing the wide variety of things that require licensing.
Yeah.
So yes, the there are quite a wide range of fees that are going to be going up. What we're not going to see increases for are farmers market stalls and street artists. If you plan to do a little performance, a little mime, or just stand as a statue in the street, that does actually cost £30 to be a licensed street artist. But that and farmers markets is staying the same. We're going to see street trading in Upper Gardiner Street go up by £10, and the same for street traders in other parts, outer parts of the city. So that is your ice cream van and that sort of thing. But in the city centre, there are a few stalls that are set up, and it's going to cost the larger stalls about £90 extra a year. We're also going to see some increases for sex entertainment establishments. Now, it's not something I've really thought about in Brighton, but apparently there are three. And off the top of my head, I can roughly think where two of them are, but I'm not sure where the third is. And they're going to see an increase. And also the Hackney and private hire drivers, they're going to see an increase of about 2% on 1 to 3 year licenses.
Yeah.
But that's actually going to be more like a fiver on a 3-year license and £1 or £4 on a 1-year one. So it's been a very, very tough 18 months for the taxi trade in the city. And I can imagine there may be some throwback on that, but we'll have to wait and see if anything is said at the meeting on Thursday. And also there's animal breeding and boarding and sales, one of which is listed as animal vending. I almost thought of a hamster in some form of vending machine, but that actually is licensing a pet shop. You don't stick your pound in and get a little pound, a little hamster drop out of a machine, but it's just the word vending. So that's sort of going to go up about £7 or £8 a pop. And that's going up for debate. There may be cases where some of the councillors might say a bit too much, or they might want to add a little bit more onto some of the venues, like the casinos maybe. So licensing fees, it's a way the council generates cash.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I do know that alleyway very well because it's by the bus stop. So it's good to see that the police are a bit concerned about that, because it is used for other issues. And, you know, I feel a bit sorry for the flat owners there along there, apartment owners, because obviously they're walking past all these bright lights, etc. So I'm pretty certain they're probably not happy about it. So the application is for people to go through the actual Vera Gusto
place, and is that it? Go through the shop? Or?
No. It will be accessed by the public through this alleyway.
Yeah.
And I know what you mean about that. All of St. James's Street has got its issues with street drinking and drug dealing and so on.
Yeah.
And the police have paid a lot of attention to that area. I mean, goodness me, when I first took on this role 2 years ago, it was one of the first things I ended up covering were the issues in that area. So it will be interesting to see what happens at this meeting.
Brilliant. Oh, we'll leave it there. That's Sarah Booker-Lewis, local democracy reporter, and we'll be speaking to her again next week. So join us then.